see. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Ridge Chapel. It's so good to have you all here worshiping with us this morning. Joe says we have a wild bunch. I'm not sure. I have just a couple announcements that I want to make sure you're aware of. They're in the bulletin, by the way, and also on the calendar that Chelsea puts out. But I do want to remind you that the leadership meeting is tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Also, that the Daily Bread Devotion booklets for the next 3 months are back there. Please pick those up. Take them to your neighbors. We get lots of them, and we'd like to share them. And the last thing is that next week, Jim Bliffen from Pioneer Bible Translators will be here. He'll bring the morning message as well as give an update during Sunday school. That's next week. Jim Bliffen from Pioneer Bible Translators, which is our monthly mission this month. All right, let's stand together, please, and read together the call to worship this morning. Oops, stay down here for that. Comes from Ephesians 1, 3 to 4. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Let's sing together. Do we have joy this morning?
It sounded like it earlier, and that's singing. Sing like we do.
I have the joy down in my heart. As we prepare for communion this morning, I want to make sure that you have your emblems and you're ready to participate during the meditation time. In my heart, there rings a melody.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. It's the melody of love. There rings a melody with heaven's heart.
perfect, how would you think about perfect? What would you think about perfect? We're like a perfect today. Perfect is one of them words that's just kind of put out. You look perfect. It's a perfect fit. It tastes perfect. You have ruined a perfectly good set of shoes. I heard that from my neighbor this week. And my car runs perfect. There's all kinds of avenues for perfect. A perfect sense of direction. I don't have to ask for direction. You ever hear that before? So I don't stop and ask for. Back when I was a kid, which has been a few days ago, in my day anyway, when you wanted to go to some destination and you found a person that knew where that destination was, you'd say, well, how do I get there? And he'll say, oh, you turn right at the lumberyard, you go 12 blocks and you turn left at the Dairy Queen, and you turn to your right and you go 4 more blocks and there's your destination. Well, that's pretty simple, you know, as far as direction is concerned. But today we have this deal from the satellite deals, about 6,000 satellites up there that's sending down some message of all the areas around us, and it's called GPS. So I hook up my little GPS and I'm going towards my kid's place. Sometimes it's a little tough, we have to go around stuff, and so I punch in the address and the code and all this there, and then next thing you know, this little chick comes on and said, hey, veer to your left in 1 mile, get in your right-hand lane and turn left, and then go 2 blocks and turn right and you'll be there, okay? So you kind of get distasteful listening to her voice, but isn't this a perfect world? I mean, gee, we got everything right before us. But we look a little bit deeper in this perfect perfection. God's perfect love, it says in his word, cast out all fear. Isn't that an awesome perfectness? And then in Matthew, it talks about being perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Perfect and complete. That brings on another whole realm of who I should be. We all have destinations in life, and we need to find our way. And so we commit our ways to the Lord. That's what he's talking about here in Psalms. Commit your ways to the Lord, and he will see you through. In John 14, chapter 14, verse 6, it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So we have a lot of perfection here before us. Being able to gather around the Lord's table today, perfection is there. Perfection is there. The GPS of the Bible talks about God's perfect sacrifice. That's what that means. It doesn't mean that some odd thing that's hanging from the earth and hanging from the sky. God's perfect sacrifice, and that's what we get to join ourselves together today and witness through our fellowship together, God's perfect sacrifice. Let's take the bread together. And now the cup, please. Now let us pray. Lord, we're grateful that you have allowed us to strive for the perfection that only you can provide in our lives. We think of the song, Lord, of your perfecting ways and how you blessed us as your children. We ask that you'll help us today to be mindful of your presence, that we would hunger and thirst for your righteousness in our lives, that we might be honorable to you in our daily lives. So give us, Lord, more complete directions as you'd have us set our feet this week, that those that we come in contact with, we might assure them of God's perfect sacrifice. Thank you for this time we can share together. Ask for your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
So we've been singing this morning about the joy that we have in the Lord, but unfortunately Satan's always out there trying to bring us down, isn't he? We can just tell him to go away and we can sing this song together. Why so downcast, O my soul? Put your hope in God.
To begin this message this morning in a little bit different way. I'm going to ask that we all stand and sing the doxology together. So if you will, please stand. Leave off the amen this time.
Praise God.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Well, good. That's what I'm going to say. Let's sing it again now and sing it with more power and feeling. And this time we'll add the amen. Okay?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above. Ye heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Okay, fine. You can be seated now. I mean, it's no secret, evidently, that to you that I am older than the average preacher. And before anybody begins whispering around, he's 91 years old. I want to beat you to the punch, although I'm too late. and announce, yes, I am 91 today. Now, I don't know whether I should say I'm so thankful to God to be 91 and still able to preach, or to confess I'm rather proud to be 91 and able to preach, or maybe both. But I know that it is only by the grace, love, and protection of God that I have reached this point in my life. So you can understand why I asked you to stand and sing with me, Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Now, I realize that God has used a number of people to help me reach this milestone. More than anyone else, I credit my wife, for her, Ethel, for her patience, care, and love for nearly 68 years now. I just don't have the words magnificent enough to express my love and appreciation, even though I know I don't do it very well. However, that does remind me of the story about four golfers playing golf in heaven. Now, I know some of you have heard this, but before you take me seriously, let me say that I've never heard anything about golf in heaven. But according to the story, they were playing golf in heaven, and one man complained, if my wife hadn't been giving me all those vitamin pills, I would have been here a whole lot sooner. Now, I could go on and mention other family members and teachers and doctors and friends who have had quite an impact on my life in a variety of ways. But because of time restraints and my failing memory, I wouldn't dare to try to name them all. I have truly been blessed. But while all these have had a part in helping me live this long, there are some in particular who have made it possible for me to still be preaching. Over the last few years, when I was sick or when I was in the hospital, our elders have always been ready to step in and take on my responsibilities and to find ways to lighten my load. In fact, we currently have here in this congregation at least seven men capable of filling the pulpit when I'm ready, filling the pulpit. And a couple of whom would be ready to do it on a moment's notice. Not only has God truly blessed me and my family, He has richly blessed our congregation. I've heard, I imagine you have too, that in the typical congregation, 90% of the work is done by 10% of the people. As people have been moving away from the rural areas and the small towns into larger towns and cities, they are leaving behind more and more smaller churches. And as a result, one preacher expressed his frustration in not being able to find help in the church nursery. His congregation was made up primarily of retired individuals, and when asked to help, they would answer, "I've done my share, let someone else do it." Now, a church once put this notice in their bulletin. If you could hear it, it says, "Church mourns death of a prominent member." The church was saddened this past week to learn of the death of one of its most prominent members, someone else. Someone else's passing creates a vacancy that will be difficult to fill. Someone else has been with us for so many years. Someone else did far more than a normal person's share of the work. Whenever there was a job to be done, a class to be teach, or a lesson meeting to attend, one name was almost always on everyone's list. Let someone else do it. It was common knowledge that someone else was more than most generous, among the most generous givers in the church. Whenever there was a financial need, everyone just assumed that someone else would make up that difference. Someone else was a wonderful person, sometimes appearing to be almost superhuman. But a person can only do so much. Where the truth known, everyone expected too much of someone else. Now someone else is gone. We wonder what we're going to do. Someone else is a wonderful, set us a fun, wonderful example to follow. But who is going to do the things someone else did? Now, that's an interesting article, and I thought you might be interested in hearing it. There are so many reasons why people don't help in church. Now, here are some reasons or excuses I thought of. Sometimes it's because they feel that they have done enough for the church in the past, and now it's their right to just sit in the pews. Sometimes churches even have the attitude that ministry is what the preacher and youth minister does. Like I said, there are many reasons why people don't do ministry in the church. I believe the principal reason people don't do ministry in the church is because they don't understand how important and critical their service is to Christ and his church. Now look at the Apostle Paul. Paul is one of the best known apostles in the New Testament. Paul's name is mentioned more often than anyone else's name other than Jesus. And this may be a result of the fact that Paul wrote nearly half of the New Testament himself. Someone has recorded that religious leaders in Judaism dismiss Jesus as a, deluded and uneducated country preacher, who was later misrepresented by his followers. Jesus, they can forgive. But Paul's influence was so powerful in the early church that some Jewish religious leaders literally despised him as a traitor. Paul had been a Pharisee, a student of the great Gamaliel, and an early persecutor of the church. These religious leaders believed that had it not been for Paul, the church would not have become as strong and influential as it did. Now, some people believe that Paul literally turned the world upside down all by himself, but he didn't. Now, consider the list of friends and companions Paul mentions in Colossians, the 4th chapter, verses 7 through 18. Now, I'm at that passage, I'm in this place, because in our Sunday school classes, adult classes, we are studying, and today's the last part of Colossians. And so, looking at that last part, Paul lists a number of names. For example, Tychicus was with Paul on part of his missionary journeys and was a letter carrier for Paul to places like Colossae and Ephesus and to men like Titus and Timothy. Aristarchus traveled regularly with Paul and was with Paul when Paul was mobbed in Ephesus, shipwrecked in the Mediterranean, and was later imprisoned. Epaphras apparently was also imprisoned with Paul, according to Philemon, the 1st chapter, the 23rd verse, and was a man dedicated to the ministry of prayer. Then there were other people like Onesimus, once a runaway slave owned by Philemon, who proved himself so useful to Paul that Paul asked for his freedom so he could continue to serve beside him. Mark, who wrote the gospel that bears his name, who was with Paul on his first missionary journey. Luke, who composed the gospel of Luke and the book of Acts, and was Paul's faithful companion during most of his ministry. And then there were other lesser known people that Paul mentions in the last part of Colossians. Nympha, who hosted a church in her home. Archippus, either a preacher or teacher, at least an important leader there at Colossae. And then Justus and Demas are mentioned. The point is, Paul didn't do it all by himself. These were just some of the people who were his fellow ministers. In fact, in his letters, Paul mentions over 100 different individuals who worked alongside him, encouraging him and assisting him, and made his ministry stronger. The American poet Gil Scott Heron wrote, "Nobody can do everything, but everybody can do something. And if everybody does something, everything will get done. That's pretty good. Paul didn't do ministry alone. In fact, Paul couldn't have done what he did by himself. And that's why I believe God listed so many people as Paul's companions in the pages of the New Testament. But I believe there's an even more important reason why God deliberately listed so many of Paul's co-workers in the New Testament. Because he wanted to tell us that he counts the labor of every member as important to the success of his church. Now, as an example of my failing memory, sometime a few weeks ago, one of our men for the communion meditation led the communion meditation by reading about Jesus sending Peter and John into Jerusalem with these instructions. Now, I've asked about half a dozen of our men, were you the one that did it? And either I'm not the only one who's forgotten, but anyway, whoever it was, if you were the one, you can let me know after the service. But here, let me read Jesus' instructions. As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house, the teacher asked, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room, all furnished. Make preparations there. They left and found things just as Jesus had said. So they prepared the Passover. Now, why did God take the time to tell us about the man who had the upper room all furnished for Jesus and his disciples? Why tell us of a man whose name is never mentioned in the Bible? Why would God do that? Well, I believe that because even this unnamed man performed an important service for Jesus. Even though we may never know who he was, God does. And because of this man's faithful service, the most important meal in the entire Bible came off just the way Jesus planned it. You see, the labor of every Christian in the church is important to Jesus and critical to the success of the witness of the church. So it's vital. If we're going to be a blessing the way Jesus wants us to be, that as many of us as possible must find a way to be of some service in the church. And sadly, it's often reported, as I mentioned earlier, that in the average church, 10% of the people do 90% of the work. But that statement got me to thinking, what percentage of people here in Ridge Chapel participate in our ministry and witness. Would you like to know? Well, I did. So I began making a list. I wrote down ways in which both members and non-members have been serving. Here's a partial list. Those who taught a class, I had a special study group. Who preached a sermon, served as greeters, helped in children's church, participated in our prayer ministry, helped enhance our singing as part of an ensemble or special music on Sunday mornings, helped make our vacation Bible school such a success, helped prepare food for our fellowship meals, and for those who are sick and recovering, and for special occasions, and so on and so on. As you may realize, I stopped before mentioning some of the tasks that are seldom mentioned, such as choosing the songs we sing, preparing the communion emblems, working in the sound booth, playing the piano or other musical instruments, preparing the Sunday bulletin and PowerPoints each week, and the monthly planning sheets. I could keep on going, but I have to stop somewhere, so please forgive me if I didn't include something you are doing in the life of this congregation. Now, after mentioning all those tasks, I came up with three conclusions that I want you to realize, too. Number one, there's a lot more going on in the life and ministry of Ridge Chapel than most people, including me, would normally ever realize. In fact, I just now realized that I didn't even go into our mission outreach and all those involved in that. Number two, to the best of my calculations, more than 90% of the people regularly attending Ridge Chapel, members and non-members alike, are serving in some special way in the life and witness of Ridge Chapel. Number three, and I want you to know how blessed I feel to be serving in a church like this, where so many of you take your part in God's kingdom seriously. Now, I want to stress, your ministry for Jesus is critical. Now, you may think that Ridge Chapel can get along just fine without the service that you contribute. Maybe you don't think your participation in the life and witness of all is all that critical. But what if it is more critical and vital than you imagine? So I want to share with you a story that comes out of World War II. In World War II, an Allied bombing raid had just returned to its base in England. And they told an amazing story. It seems that while on their bombing run, they had been hit several times by German anti-aircraft gunners, but that none of the shells had exploded. Specialists gingerly removed the shells from the plane, took them away to a safe place to examine them. What they discovered was this: the shells contained no firing pins. And in the place of the firing pins, a note was found, written in the Czech language. The note was apparently put there by one of the slave laborers in a German munitions plant. It said, "This is all we can do for now. Wish we could do more." You know, there's an old hymn that begins with these words: "There's a place for every worker in the vineyard of the Lord." And it's true. Oh, it's true. There's a place for you, for me, as long as God permits me to do so and gives me a strength to do so. There's a place for you. Now, we often talk about, and we are, a family, a part of God's family, wherever we are. But you're here. If you're not a Christian, we invite you to become a part of that family, His family, to confess His name, to pledge your allegiance to Him, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, to follow His example and command in baptism, to rise, to walk a part of His fellowship and a part of ours. Or if you've already done all that and you now live here, then make yourself known. Come and say, "This is where I want to serve as long as I'm here, as long as God permits me." That's the way we should all feel. So if you have a decision you need to make, would you come? We're ready to receive you. We're ready to rejoice with you. Will you come as we stand and sing? This song. And I meant to bring a hymn book and read off the first part of each of those verses. Like, "Take my hands, take my feet, take my mouth, take my will, take me." If that's the way you feel, let's sing one more verse. Please be seated, everybody except you.
Thank you.
I'm happy to welcome Mark and Lynn Geese.
right.
EC.
EC.
EC. EC.
Oh, okay.
Close enough.
I put the, well, close.
Yeah.
You see, okay.
There you go.
All right.
Thank you.
They come from Tulsa, from the Park Church of Christ, as immersed believers in Him. And they now live here in Ridge Chapel. And they've been here a few times. They came, a year or so ago for the first time and said they liked it. And then when they've moved here, they say, well, this is where they want to serve. And so I welcome them, but I want to ask them once again, and every Christian here this morning, to repeat after me the words of the Apostle Peter, the confession he made long, long ago. Take my hand, please. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And my Savior.
And my Savior.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And as a minister, I welcome you to the fellowship of this congregation. May God bless you and us as we serve Him together.
Thank you.
And I... All right, you can be seated then.
This concludes today's worship service. Thank you for listening. We hope you were encouraged by joining us on Facebook Live. Please message us if you have questions or would like more information. May God bless you and give you His peace.